at the University of Virginia, especially Glenn Crossman, who has really put in long hours on this over the past six, 7 months. And we appreciate everything Glenn does. He's involved in our annual production. So thank you very much.
Bear so that everyone can see it in 2020, which will be an important moment in an election year. We're all
received another Emmy nomination for her performance as Penny Levin on the beloved HBO series The Leftovers.
Woo-woo!
You don't sound left over to me. Ann's television career has been highlighted by acclaimed performances in Judging Amy, Third Watch, Beasts and Geeks, among others. Her film work has included Captain Fantastic, Flags of Our Fathers, The Informant, Marley and Me, Philadelphia, and one that always gives me the creeps, The Manchurian Candidate. I could go on and on, but you want to hear from her, and so do I. Please join me in giving a warm cheer. And that's really what I wanted to ask you about the that's a good work in some areas, but that is a lot of Ted Cruz. See, I'm director of the Center for Politics. I don't run anything. Nobody listens to me. So just so you understand, except the students are going to be graded down if there's a negative reaction to it. But getting back to the Handmaid's Tale, because the more I watched it, the more disturbed I got. You're living in the most awful kind of authoritarian society, which is what we fear may gradually be happening. What is it like to be in that kind of atmosphere, knowing, of course, that you're acting and your colleagues are acting, but you do assume the role, and it's powerful.
Well, you said something very important, which is to say, for us, it is make-believe. When I come home at the end of the night after a 16-hour day, everybody has their arms, everybody has their eye, no one is being forced to have sex with the commander. Do you know what I'm saying? Otherwise, we couldn't do the work. Which is not to say we trivialize it. During the election, when we began shooting The Handmaid's Tale, we were all still saying, it's not going to happen. There's no way Trump was going to be elected, is he? And, of course, we all know what happened. I was home in New York. We shoot in Canada, by the way, in Toronto. And I was in touch with Elizabeth Moss and Alfred, of course. And I went to bed at midnight the night before because I couldn't believe where it was all going. And I got up in the morning, and at the foot of my door was the result of the election in the New York Times. And I wrote to her and I said, what are we ever going to do? And she wrote back in Latin, don't let the bastards ride you down. And of course, you know where that came from. I don't know what my point is here, but I'm so sorry you had a lot of that for me. But you know, doing the show gave us, it was like a form of activism, that we got to put our energy at CP loading already. I'm so sorry if I offend.
Don't worry about it, it happens all the time.
Here it was a way of putting a face and a language and words to what we saw happening. And to, you know, you enter that world, Lydia fascinates me. Because our job, of course, as an actor is, first of all, rule number one, don't judge. Because you judge in the knowing selves. It's like a relationship, like a friendship. You tell me about me and I'll tell you about you. You tell me about you and I'll tell you about me. And then we'll get to know one another. And it'll take time, and I respect that. So can you tell me what you know I can live with right now? It's a beautiful thing. Because, and after seeing this, the more we come to understand one another, the judgment falls away, isn't it? Something about understanding another's pain, or the reasons why a person is the way they are. It's much harder to judge them, and hate dissolves. So Lydia, the question is, what in the world happened there, honey? Well, you know, and this is going to get scarier because you think, what's the damage in your youth? Who raised you and why like that? So you imagine, and the writers were quite helpful. You know, mother not present, father very religious, sex was all about shame. Shame ruled her day, and humiliation so unresolved in her life. A failed marriage, she just shut down. Shut down. Sure, she was right. And the only way through is this way. Remember, you know the play Doubt? Mm-hmm. Good play.
Yeah.
Aloysius is a wonderful role to play. And her salvation at the end is that she lets doubt in. And then her life begins. It's the final moment of the play. She realizes, oh my God, I was sure I was right, and my point of view was right, and everybody else was wrong. And she had that remarkable experience of saying, maybe I was wrong. Lydia hasn't had that moment. Now, jump ahead to the Testaments, which is the sequel to Handmaids. It happens 15 years after the Iliad we know from Handmaids. Margaret Atwood doesn't kid around. She doesn't go with that notion. smart, years ahead of us all. I should speak for myself, of me. Lydia is the way she is to survive. Because the regime took over Gilead, and they went, she was a family court judge. They went right to the courts after annihilating Congress. And they said, come on out, and we're going to figure out who's going to work for us and who isn't. And those who didn't were dead within 24 hours. She said, you know what? Now I am going to live. I'm going to do this better than any of them. It was about survival, which to me is terrifying. So.
And you were going to, you gave me a little hint behind the scenes that things might look up. We have to have a positive note or two. For this
yeah,
audience.
Yeah. Oh, well, that's a good novel. I don't know, yeah, I would jump on it as soon as you can. Just because of what ends up happening to Gilead and why. It's very, very satisfying, and very satisfying for Lydia. I hope I'm not giving too much away.
No, we appreciate it. How about our society and dealing with the potential for more authoritarianism here and abroad? I know you feel strongly about civic participation and the role that each one of us can play. Can you tell us about that?
Well, you know, we saw so much of it, how important it is to speak up, to not turn a blind eye. We can't. I mean, I get sick to my stomach and I say, too bad about you. Step up, do something. Contact your representative, whatever it is. I'm going to speak to something a little, because I don't know how I answer that in an intelligent manner. Do you know what I'm saying? I live in New York City. There's two things I want to say that doesn't take you off your questions. Is that all right?
Well, that's fine. Go ahead.
My son is African American, my youngest boy. I have two older children, and my little boy, Trust, was my foster son at 9 months. His father is from Liberia, and his mother is from the Bronx. I say this to you in confidence, even if that sounds absurd. Let's pretend we're family, if you don't mind. He's here in Virginia with me, but he didn't come today. I don't know, he couldn't, whatever that means. He's 14. I'll just leave it there. At any rate, it's a funny world, the foster agency, and by funny I mean terrifying, because a child has been removed from the home of someone. And it's easy to say, well, they couldn't manage it. They were terrible parents, drug addicts, whatever they were. You know, really, it's a far more complicated situation. And this woman, who's the mother of Trust, struggled terribly. And I believe she had a mental illness that was not diagnosed and therefore never treated. Never got the help. Therefore could not manage the raising of a child. And it meant so much to her. You have to do programs. You have to do parenting, anger management, substance abuse, whatever it is, you have to do it. And you have to do it thoroughly. And then gradually you get visits without the management of the co-worker. Then you have time alone overnight. You know, it's very gradual, and then the court decides you can have your child or no. And 2 weeks before she used to get her son back after doing all the programs, everything, she stopped showing up. And I'm sure she was dead, because I knew how much she wanted to see have a boy. And the place where she was living, the man called and said, I think there's something totally wrong. There's been murders in the neighborhood, and I think she's been harmed because she's not come home. And I said, well, we have to do a missing persons immediately. Well, the agency couldn't do it. It's part of their policy. The mother has to be in charge of her life. I called the police. I said, I have to register. They came to the home, saw that he was number one black, and number two, a foster child. Not interested. Forgive me for generalizing, because many law enforcement people in Manhattan who can't speak to the country are very good to us and helping. But at any rate, I said, no, I've got to have a name. I need help. And they gave me a name of a detective. And I called and I said, he said, who gave you this number? I was curious. And then they go on Rikers, it's the prison in Manhattan, they're going to shut it down for important reasons. At any rate, I said, no, 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 she's not. It was silly, she's going to get her son back. He said, what's her birth date? What does she look like? And I described her. He called back in 10 minutes, she's in Rikers. My point, she could not face getting her son back and failing again because her wellness had not changed. She could not face it alone. Now, she wouldn't tell you that, but my respect for her, if this makes any sense, went sky high again because she was trying to protect him. Now, when I tell you that the two of us were at war, and I mean at war, mothers, the mother of that boy, now my son, and I, she wanted me to be, you can imagine, if somebody raised my kid, you'd have to put me in prison to keep me from harassing her. I mean, think about it. And the things she would say to me, and the thing I would be thinking, what is happening? How did, what? One day he was put in a psychiatric hospital. He had 7 homes in the first 6 years of his life. And she would call me, our boy's in danger. And all differences go away. All hatred, whatever that is. All distrust. I said, what do we do? What do we do? How do we do? Well, we love the same child. And therefore, we love each other. I don't know if that makes the slightest sense, but when I saw that film today, all I could think of is if we could just come to understand our brothers and sisters who are different. I am blessed with an oldest boy who was autistic on the spectrum. He taught me about different. I'm rambling, I'm so sorry, but that's what occurs to me at the end of the day. What happened here? In Charlottesville. When I first saw that, it was after a long day of filming, and I turned the news on and I thought that they were showing footage from decades ago. I couldn't believe it was the present. And I had to stop talking, please.
No, no, look, your rambles are better than my lectures.
Who are not willing to stand up and say, no, I'm sorry, we have lost our way, and I am going to step away, and I am going to denounce what is going on here. I don't care if I'm ever re-elected, it doesn't matter. Much more is at stake. What I saw there and what I heard come out of his mouth after Charlottesville was so staggering. I'm just saying things that are so obvious and old. You know, he was saying to me earlier, which I thought was so interesting. I cannot believe that people are willing to sell their souls, people that are elected in this country. I don't even mean religiously, whether you believe in hell or you don't. Sir, madam, you have lost the core of you as a human being because you have given up your integrity. And so I said, it's my pleasure, and I was putting these together. to leave, and I said, what is your name? And he said, John. And that's my father.
Oh my God.
And I thought to myself, if you ever forget how simple it is to give to a mother, just to take a minute. And it happened again the following year. I said the prayer again, and I walked out, forgot about it. And I had it on one of the dogs. And the man said, could I pet your dog? I said, sure you can. And he told me all about dogs. He had been raised with dogs. And I said, where are you? And clearly he was homeless. I could tell from his clothing, his, you know, he hadn't had a chance to shower, did he? And I said, tell me, where are you from? He said, well, and he named his state. And he said, I was on the boats that come into to the harbor here in New York. The captain was a fraud, and he was arrested, and we were all thrown off the ship. And I've been homeless now for a while. I said, well, but what about your family? Where's your family? He said, well, I've lost my cell phone, and I don't know their numbers. And so I said, well, you've got to get help. There's a way. This is America. And I said, listen now. We're going to go to Salvation Army. It's right down the street. This is what they do. You have to reach out. And we're going to tell them your situation. He said, oh no, I don't like to ask for help. I said, you must ask for help. You have to ask for help because you deserve it. And then I said something about, I was showing him something. He said, I don't read. I said, well, honey, how is it you don't read? He said, well, I was never taught. We had to work on the farm and things. And I said, oh, okay. I'm going to put together some food and things. I would have brought him upstairs in 2 seconds, but I lived with, you know, you got to ask, you know what I'm saying? My husband's a New Yorker. That would have really been good. Bring them all in. So I said, listen, I want you to come sit in the back on the bed. She said, no, they'll throw me out. I said, darling, they're not going to throw you out. She said, yeah, they are. I said, all right, here's my name, and I'm 11F, and here's my number. You tell them this information. I'll be down as soon as I can. And I ran upstairs, like, whatever, and my children, you see, my youngest boy, the 14-year-old, his mother was homeless many times. If he gets anything, he sees someone homeless, he just hands it to them. Allowance, take it. And so I said, come on, guys, go to we'll bring together a meal. Everybody, let's go. Everybody, what do you think would be necessary? What would be helpful to this man? My son said, ibuprofen. Just wanted to come with me.
please join me in a final round of applause for our special guest. Again, we have to move to a reception rather quickly, but I know several of you.